Greetings, sailors, and welcome to my first look at the Emmanuel Filiberto Duca D'Aosta, although I'm not sure we'll use the full name every time. This is the first of the Italian ships in the game, and it's a Tier 6 light cruiser. So don't expect too much from it armor-wise, and you won't be disappointed. It's got a couple of interesting characteristics, this one. It's got a very fast straight line speed. It is, in fact, the fastest of the Tier 6 cruisers, and it might be one of the fastest cruisers in the game overall. And it's got a very fast shell speed. And those are the two kind of standout defining characteristics of this machine. And the speed of it in the water alone is probably one of the outstanding factors that makes it kind of fun to play, even though there are some other things about it that are distinctly mediocre. But overall, my impression of this ship is pretty positive. Now, I've got two replays for you, as per usual. And what I've done this time is I've waited until the release of the ship and the final release stats to actually do this video, because it had a couple of stat changes whilst we were previewing it, the biggest being it went from having 6 kilometer to 12 kilometer torps, but the speed dropped a lot on those torpedoes. But there were some other minor changes along the way, and one of the final changes, in fact, was to the rudder shift time, which when we were previewing was something like 10 seconds ish as the base rudder shift, and that's actually dropped quite significantly, which is a very welcome addition. So this first one is a tier 8 game, as you can see, and it's going to be quite an average game. As you can see, the matchmaking wasn't that good. It was a tier 8 game, but in how it performed while I was playing like I was playing, this was a very average game. I had a lot of games that had this kind of damage result at the end. The next game is going to be something a bit different, and it's maybe going to be more how the ship should be played, but it's not always going to be how the ship can be played. But I'll explain what I mean by that once I've gone through all the stats. So first off, hit points. You've got 29,700, which is very slightly below average for the tier. There's nothing much to say there. It's okay. The average actually at tier 6 is kind of skewed up by both Cleveland and the Graf Spee, because they've got a good few thousand more than everyone else, but most of the ships are just under or just over 31,000. So this is, yeah, it is pretty average for its tier. You've got 7% torpedo bulge protection, so you'll get a little bit of a reduction on torpedoes that hit your torpedo bulge, and I mean, there's not a great deal to choose from at tier 6. The Graf Spee gets 22%, but that's kind of a funny ship in its own regard. Most of the rest of the pure cruisers are, they've got between 0 and 10%. So 7% is on the upper end of the scale. It's better than nothing, I suppose, but it's not going to save you ultimately. The armor I will talk about in a little more detail at the end, but again, there's not a lot to say there. It's a rather thinly armored cruiser. It's not as thinly armored as, say, the Nürnberg, but you don't have a lot going for you. Think around the level of armor on the Molotov. The Citadel protection and scheme is a little different, but it's not a particularly heavily armored ship, and you're not going to bounce really any battleship shells unless you get quite lucky. The bow armor especially is only 13 millimeters, so I think basically every battleship you can meet is going to be able to overpen that, or overmatch that rather. But you will be able to, with angling, bounce the 6-inch AP shells of other similar tier cruisers you might meet. The guns? Well, the guns are where this thing starts to get a little interesting. Now, the caliber is perfectly standard 6-inch caliber, which is, that's an awkward way to say that, but hey, I'm recording this late, so expect lots of awkward phrasing. It's got a 4x2 turret arrangement, 2 in the front and 2 in the back, which is something that I personally like, and there are there's a healthy mix at this tier of 3x3 and 4x2s, and there's even a couple of 4x3s in there, but personally I prefer a 4x2 turret arrangement, just because it gives a more balanced feel to the ship, and this certainly does have that fairly balanced feel. The turret angles are actually not bad as well, but if you're facing down a battleship, you're going to want to resist the temptation, or even an 8-inch gun cruiser, you're going to want to resist the temptation to angle out too much. In this particular situation here, I was quite safe with the terrain, more or less, and knowing that nobody was aiming their guns at me, so I was able to get in some free shots just there. But it has an equal amount of firepower, whether it's coming or going, basically, and in my eyes, that's always a welcome thing. The rate of fire is pretty good. It's got 8 rounds a minute, or a 7.5 second reload, which is on a par with the Leander and the Perth, and of course they've only got AP shells, this has got HE. The turret turn time is more average. We're getting to a more average stat here. It's got 25.7 seconds, which is, that is actually just about the average for tier 6. There's lots of the ships that have around 25 seconds, so nothing special there. But, you know, you get expert marksman on there as a captain skill, and you can improve it a little bit, of course. And lastly, the range. Well, actually, the range and the dispersion. We'll obviously cover the range first. 14 kilometers. Now, this is one of the mediocre parts of the ship. It's not the worst at tier 6, but it's not far off being the worst at tier 6. Now, the Perth gets that dubious distinction with 12.8 kilometers, followed by the Leander with just a couple hundred meters more at 13.2. So 14's not great, but then you look at the Cleveland with 14.6, the Elba's got 14.9, so it's not like it stands out as being hugely bad. 14 kilometers you can kind of live with, but it does make being down tiered a bit more awkward. Now the good news is, though, that you have a spotter plane, and that gives you an extra 20% to your range, which puts it out to about 16.8 kilometers. So with judicious use of the spotter plane, the fact that your base range is 14 doesn't actually feel that bad, quite honestly. It will be a limitation sometimes. I had one game, for instance, where I was being constantly spotted by a destroyer, and there was a pair of Fusos that were just pelting away at me from like 18 kilometers consistently, and there wasn't really a lot I could do except withdraw, but fortunately I had the speed to do it. Dispersion, lastly, on this particular group of stats, it's 130 meters dispersion at the 14 kilometers range, which is not super accurate, I don't think. That's probably roughly, in terms of the horizontal dispersion anyway, around what the Cleveland gets. But the Cleveland does have more guns available, so obviously that makes a difference. As to the Sigma value, I couldn't tell you, but I mean, it doesn't feel especially bad. It's not the laser accurate Molotov guns, I can tell you that. But there is one thing about these guns that is actually quite Molotov-like, and it's quite Budioni-like as well. And that brings us on to your actual shells. Now, in terms of the damage, it's 3200 for the AP and 2100 for an HE Citadel, which is about what you'd expect for a 6-inch gun cruiser. There is a downside with your shells. You have the worst HE fire chance at tier 6. It's actually worse than the Nurnberg. You've got 7%. So Demo Expert is kind of a must, just to bring you up to not even what the other cruisers get, but yeah, you want Demo Expert if you want to be setting fires. As a little aside, IFHE might also be very desirable on this ship, because yeah, it takes away some of your fire chance again, and you will want Demo Expert and IFHE together, but your HE damage output might well improve overall. But I was only using like a 6-point captain on this, so I did not get to the point of being able to test out IFHE. But I have a feeling IFHE with the HE shells might just do more damage, even though you're still going to be struggling to actually set fires. But the real standout stats of the ammunition are the muzzle velocities, the shell speeds. Your AP has 1,000 meters a second. The HE has 950. Now, the HE is not exceptional. It's good for this tier. The Budioni has 950, the Nuremberg gets 960, the Molotov's got 920, the Grafspey gets 910 for the HE shells. So it's good for the tier, it really is, but it doesn't stand above anybody else particularly. But the AP, the 1,000 meters a second AP, that is by far and away the best. The Nuremberg also gets 960 with its AP. But you only gets 950, so you know, there are other ships that have fast shells at this tier, but 1,000 meters a second is, yeah, that's the clear winner. Now the reason for this is the Italians liked to supercharge their shells. They stuck extra charge bags in, basically, and that came at the cost of barrel life, but it meant that the shells came out of the barrel that much faster. And the fact that your HE and AP have different velocities might actually throw you a little bit. It took me a while to adjust, and in both replays you will see me, when switching between AP and HE, sometimes struggling a bit, because that 50 meters a second difference does make a difference. So that's one of the outstanding things, is that AP velocity. And the arcs are fairly flat as well. We're not quite, like I say, we're not talking the Molotov rail guns here in terms of the accuracy and the arcs, but yeah, overall I found the shells very comfortable to use, apart from that low fire chance. You've got a couple of secondaries, 4.5 kilometers, not much to say there. There's only a couple per side, 3 twin mounts. In fact, that's going to be like one per side and then one on the fore deck or one on the aft deck. Didn't even note where they were exactly. So if you're very, very lucky, you might occasionally get like a close quarters on a very low health destroyer or something. But yeah, tier 6 secondaries on cruisers, there's not a lot to get excited about there. The AA rating, it's not good news. This is definitely one of the weaknesses of the ship. It's not the weakest AA at tier 6. Again, that dubious honor goes to the Perth. But it's not good. It's the second worst in terms of its DPS, and it actually has a worse envelope than the Perth. The Grafspey has only a little more DPS, but again, a better envelope. So the AA is not a strength of this ship at all. And the actual DPS breakdown, it's the 3.5 kilometer guns that give you the best part of your DPS. The 4 kilometer ranged stuff, it's not that good. There is a kind of an upside though. I mean, you can try and do an AA spec, but honestly you can't buff the AA on this ship very much. Even if you have like BFT and AFT and manual AA, you're only still going to manage about 100 DPS best. So it's not good. But you have defensive AA in a separate slot. That's the main upside to this ship. And that wasn't true when we first had it. They had Hydro and defensive AA in the same slot, and you had to choose between them, which is the case on most cruisers. But they decided to separate that out. So that's a nice little bonus. You will always have defensive AA available if you need it in a game. Because in a lot of games, you don't need defensive AA because they just aren't carriers. So yeah, that's definitely a weakness. Torpedoes, well, I don't think I really used the torpedoes in this game, but it went from 6 kilometer, 60 odd knots torps to, I think actually that this must have been when I had the 12 kilometer torpedoes. I must have told a fib earlier. But yeah, it went from fast short range torpedoes to 12 kilometer, 51 knot torpedoes with a very average minute and a half reload. And it's only 2 triple mount launchers. So by the time they get out to that 12 kilometers, they've taken a while to get there, and they spread out a fair bit because there's only 3 of them. Now they do have a 1 kilometer detection range, but if you're talking about reaction time, I mean, it's the best detection range of a torp across all the tier 6 cruisers. Most of them have 1.3, but most of them have faster torpedoes. This is the slowest torpedo on any cruiser at tier 6. So the fact that it gets detected a little bit less far away than, say, an Alba torpedo or a Budioni torpedo, It's not going to matter that much because it's going that much slower. So that's no special advantage, I don't think. So yeah, the torpedoes, I got to use them a couple of times. And they came in useful a couple of times. But it's one of those ships where the torpedo armament feels like an afterthought. And you're still going to get the most use of them at closer ranges. You will see it in the next game where I get a longer range hit. But it's because the person I'm using them on does not, well, they don't know I've got them, to be fair. They don't know I have torpedoes to begin with, but they were just sailing in a completely straight line and not varying speed or course at all. And so my torps were able to reach them at about 10 kilometers, but it took the torps a while to get there. So the torps aren't that useful just because they're so slow. And initially it seemed like, oh, 12 kilometer torps, that's the best range at tier 6. Yeah, but you're just running around always only dropping the torps at 12 kilometers, you're never going to hit anything. Or at best, you're very, very, very rarely going to hit anything. It just takes so long to get there. Now we're almost done with the stats, so the last things to cover are speed and detection. So we'll go with the speed and maneuverability generally. So 36.5 knots. It's the best at tier 6, only by half a knot, but it is still the best. The next is the Molotov, and if you guessed I was going to say Molotov, then well done. That is a very speedy machine. Obviously, with the Sierra Mike flag, you get quite a nice amount of benefit out of that, so that's highly recommended if you've got them. I think that puts you over 38 knots. So yeah, it's a really speedy ship. But bear in mind, it's also a fragile ship, and having played a little warships today with a patch having come out, I've already seen some of these around, and a couple of people have just like rushed to the nearest cap point and been obliterated. It's like the old school Hellcat in World of Tanks. People use that speed to get themselves into trouble very, very quickly. So you have to be careful not to do that. But it's nice that the speed is there, and it puts you on a par or even better than some destroyers. So there are times when that's going to be coming in very useful, especially if you want to get from one flank to another. So yeah, that's one of the best things about this ship, that and the shell velocity. It's just the raw speed of this thing. The turning radius is not so great, however, 710 meters, but that's not bad. That's the same as the Auber. And considering the speed of this thing, which is a knot and a half better than the Auber, it could be worse. I mean, the Molotov gets a whopping 860, the Budioni gets 710. So it's about right for the speed. It doesn't get hugely penalised compared to other ships like the Molotov does. That's actually quite a nice, you know, it's 710's not super manoeuvrable. But considering the speed, it could be worse. It could definitely be worse. Roger shift is 6.7 seconds, and this was, I think I mentioned, this was actually buffed between the preview and release. That's been a big improvement. You could still use the rudder shift equipment on this, and I obviously was using it when it was a worse base rudder shift time. But yeah, 6.7 is pretty good for the tier. It's well below average, and it's actually very nearly the best for its tier, in fact. The Alba gets 6.5, and I think the next best is like 7.6. So yeah, 6.7 is actually pretty good, and it might be that between ourselves and the super testers, we were taking more damage than they thought was appropriate for a tier 6 cruiser, or we were getting killed more often, and so they decided to make it that bit more maneuverable to be able to dodge shells better. So that was a welcome thing. Lastly, we have the detection ranges, and without camo, which you won't be playing, but yeah, the base detection is 12.5 kilometers, and with it's 12.1, so it's more or less what the Nuremberg has. It's about 100 meters better than the Nuremberg. So for its tier, it's not super stealthy, but it's not bad. The British cruisers are, of course, better. The Alba is a little bit better, and I think everything else is around the same or worse. So with the camo, I mean, that's not bad in of itself, but really you want to be going for the captain skill on top of that, which gets you down to about 10.6, which is reasonably stealthy. That gets you well within your firing range, and you can sneak up a bit closer. The air detection is 7.3. That's actually more like the new French cruiser, the La Galissonière. It's not super good for its tier. I think that's a thing they actually changed. I had it down previously as 6.3, 6.4, something like that, which would have been very good for its tier, but it's now a lot more average. So overall, it's not a particularly sneaky cruiser, but if you have a skilled captain in it, you will be able to make it reasonably decent for the tier. And sometimes that combination of stealth and speed is going to come in very, very useful. I can only imagine what it'd be like if you had this amount of raw speed and the surface detection ranges of the British cruisers. It would be really rather nice indeed. I could also perhaps note here that this is one of the very few cruisers that can stealth torpedo, but as I've already pointed out with the torpedoes, they're not that good. So that's about it for the stats, and now I can maybe talk about this game itself. Now, the first one, I was being rather standoffish, rather passive, and I think I probably played the majority of my games like that. And you might have noticed from the damage, which was, what, around 43k? Oh, hello, Nuremberg. Yeah, I didn't realise we were going to turn in like that, but okay. Yeah, it was around 43k, and that was remarkably consistent. There were a lot of games, in fact probably the majority of the games I played, where I had between 40 and 45k damage, and a big chunk of that was generally from my AP shells, because I just wasn't really setting the fires. I'd set a fire and someone would extinguish it, and then I'd hit them over and over again with HE, and that poor fire chance would come into play, and I would just be unable to set another fire. It was only maybe the last five or six games I played in this where I had Demo Expert on the captain, because it was only at that point I had a 6-point captain. So Demo Expert did improve things a little bit, but I don't think I ever had more than like four or five fires in a match. So don't expect lots of fires. Don't expect lots of fire damage. You're going to have to rely more on the main batteries themselves. So, like I said, 40 to 45k damage, it was remarkably consistent. But already I'm approaching that in this one. And I was trying to do something a bit different. I was trying to be a bit more aggressive. And I think if you want to get better damage out of this ship, you need to be a bit more aggressive. But the thing is, you're still a very thinly armoured and not super manoeuvrable cruiser. I'm about to make a huge mistake, by the way. Yes, I had forgotten that Fiji was still alive, and I'm about to pay the price. And this is where the previous more sluggish rudder reaction time kind of worked against me, in that I just took that big extra salvo that I didn't really want to take. And with the Bayern coming around from the other side, he's about to start turning his guns on me as well. There we go. It's gone from 1 to 2 in the little indicator. So that was a huge mistake on my part, just giving broadside to the Fiji like that, and just forgetting that the Fiji was still alive to begin with. That was a bit of a whoopsie. And at this point, pushing out where not only do I have this guy firing at me, but there's now a Koenig that can fire at me as well. I thought for sure I was screwed. But now the indicator's gone back to 1, so it is only the Fiji that's targeting me right now. So yeah, this one I was trying to be more aggressive, and I was trying to push things a bit more, and if I'd paid more attention, I would have more health right now. That is entirely my fault. But in the other games where I was trying to be a bit more aggressive, it's really circumstantial. You have to pick your moments and your places to do it very carefully. And especially when you're bottom tier, the ability for higher tier battleships to just blat you out of the water very quickly indeed, it goes up rather sharply. So I found being cautious in lower tier battles, I wasn't getting great scores, I wasn't getting great damage, or being bottom tier rather in higher tier battles. That makes sense. Did I mention it's late? With this being better matchmaking, And with me meeting a König that's only firing HE and has apparently a terrible aim and is driving in a nice straight line towards my very slow torpedoes, well, that's a stroke of luck. And I think to get away with being aggressive like this, you are going to need a stroke of luck, because there are other games where I was trying to play more aggressively and it did not work at all. So there's kind of two ways of playing this ship. You can play the much safer, much more passive, sticking with the pack role, and you will probably end up doing, you know, that 40 to 45k damage per game and getting maybe 1,000 base XP and picking up a kill or two if you're lucky. Or you can be more aggressive and you can take more risks, and if you play smarter than I have in this one, you could probably have more hit points than I had, but you will still take damage. And sometimes it just won't work, it won't pay off, and you don't have the armor to sustain taking the attention of multiple battleships or even, you know, heavy cruisers. So it's very easy. Like I was saying, it's like the old school Hellcat. It's very easy to get yourself into a whole heap of trouble very quickly indeed. Now, I was completely underestimating the amount of lead I needed there, because I'd been switching between the HE and the AP, and I never quite got used to how fast the shells were, but I think that's just like you would with practice. It's just the 1,000 meters a second. It's really like quite nothing else. So anyway, there's the other Fiji gone, and I was able to bounce those shells. And I was able to bounce the shells from the earlier Fiji as well, by you know, staying bow on once I was aware that he was alive and shooting at me, which was a good indicator. Yeah, 79k damage, and this was by far the best damage result I had, and it was a nice combination of, like, I was lucky at times, but also I had teammates behind me that were pulling their weight as well. And if you don't have the right combination of circumstances going for you, it probably will result in shorter battles. Battles where you get sunk if you're trying to be more aggressive. So it's really up to you. It's how confident you are as a player, basically. So I could have stayed alive for the remainder of this battle easily. And it was while I was coming forward more towards the cap circle and then realizing the Cleveland was doing exactly the same that I thought, okay, I'm probably doomed at this point, because all the Cleveland had to do was fire HE and they got me. But he went down as well, and we have basically won this. They've got one battleship left alive, a New Mexico, and what ended up happening was we won this one on points. So rather than show you the rest of that, let's just go to the score screens. So that was 82k damage in the end, and it helped that König was so bad. That was a real stroke of luck. But if I had played better myself and not lost so much to the Fiji, that could have been far more comfortable, and I might even have survived at the end there. So all in all, that was enough for a second place on the team. As you can see, the Pensacola on our team did reasonably well as well. 1800 base XP is not to be sniffed at. And of the damage that I did, most of it came from the AP, or a majority came from it from the AP. 40k versus 28k, and only 1300 damage from fires, and I had 3 fires in that one. So even with the demo expert, I wasn't setting a lot of fires. So it's no Cleveland, it's no Budioni, it's worse than a Nuremberg, and you're going to have to bear that in mind. So, it's not going to be for everybody. I think this is maybe a ship with I don't want to say a higher skill cap. I think a higher skill cap in terms of getting more damage out of it. But like I say, you can play it more passively. And if you're happy to accept that will result in lower damage games, well, I mean, that's true for all cruisers. But, you know, if you look at the range and you look at the speed and the ability to get yourself out of trouble, and you just use the spotter plane and only ever try and stay at the maximum range, you'll still do some damage. It's just you won't do as much as if you play a bit more aggressively and try a bit harder, as it were. But that's also by far the riskier way to play it, and there are times when it just will not pay off at all. So, lastly, a very quick look at the armor. There's not really that much to say about it. There's maybe one thing that's slightly of interest, but overall, it's pretty much what you'd expect. Both the fore and aft are very thinly plated with 16 mil. I might have said 13 earlier, but 16 is what I meant, honest. And most of the upper deck and superstructure is all around that kind of level as well. Interestingly, the very thickest armor you've got is not along the armor belt here, which is 70 millimeter. It's actually the conning tower with a 100 millimeter. The turret faces are a little behind that with 90 mil, but generally, yeah, it's all rather squashy. So the casements are only the barbettes rather are only about 70 mil each, so you will sometimes lose turrets, but it's a tier 6 cruiser. I mean, that's pretty much true for all of them. Now, the possibly interesting part starts when we strip away some of the outer armor. So if we look at this, we start to notice it's a very skinny shape. And actually, if you take away the auxiliary room armor, as it's labeled there, from the side, you'll note that it's a little above the waterline, but we're not talking hugely sticking above the waterline. That is, like, if you get a broadside one of these and you're aiming at the waterline, as you probably will be, you'll be able to citadel a Duca really rather easily. So don't give broadsides like I did to that Fiji. That was just a bad plan. That was me not paying attention and not realizing he was still alive. But the front profile, or the top profile, it's rather skinny. It's a very skinny citadel. It's only taking up like half the width of the deck, maybe a little more. And that's interesting. I don't know if that has any kind of particular practical application to how you actually play the thing, but I don't know if I've seen a citadel that just looks that skinny before. The actual citadel armor itself is only about 30 odd millimeters, but once you stick the outer armor on, there's an extra 20 there, and then you've got the outer 70, and so it's sufficient at an angle to bounce small caliber shells, but big caliber shells are just going to go through this thing like paper. Not quite as badly as the Nuremberg, but yeah, one of the ways you make a ship fast is by not having it be very armored, and that's why the Mutsu, for instance, is actually faster than the Nagato, because it has less armor. So, that's it for the... I don't know why we're looking at the Buddy only, by the way. I guess that's just because of what I was looking at before. But anyway, yeah, that's it for my first look at the Duca D'Aosta. Overall, a reasonably fun ship. Not going to be for everybody's taste. It's not going to fit everybody's playstyle. But if you are the kind of player that enjoys taking maybe more risks with your cruisers, it's got the speed to get away with things. And it's not crippled in mobility in its turning radius as the Molotov is. But you also don't get those Soviet railguns. Although, maybe you could argue you get Italian railguns instead. Although, yeah, they're not that accurate, really, to call them railguns. But just that speed, though, they are quite nice. So hopefully you found this useful. And if you have, you can hit the like button. You can leave any comments below. You can sub to my channel if you haven't already. And, as always, stay tuned for more.